Harold.
Thank you very much, Andrew, and thank you all for coming. It's an honour for me to be here to pay tribute to Sam Gaussen. From what I've heard from Andrew and others here, he really is, he was very special. He played a huge part in raising a lot of that 14 million that has made such a difference to our research here and around Britain and around the world. So obviously, I think you all, and we all, owe him a great debt, and it's a great pleasure and honor to be here to give the lecture in memory of him. My talk today, as Andrew said, is translating laboratory discovery into life-changing treatments. A bit of a mouthful, but something very intrinsic to everything that we do. And you'll see in front of you, there's a picture of the Institute, there's a picture of Moorfields, and in the middle, there's London Bridge, bridging the gap. And actually, today's lecture will be a sort of little wander around parts of some of the things we've been doing, but also some of the things that are happening in general, and how exciting it really is for all of us. And also, the interesting thing is when you set out to discover or do something, you find other things. And I'll mention that as well, because that's what makes research even more exciting. But first to visual impairment, okay? Vision is our most precious sense. Public surveys all show that. More than 80 to 90% of the public think that. But it's not just that people think it's important. If you ask them to rank what visual loss means to them, they'll equate it to intractable pain, they'll equate it to advanced cancer, they'll equate it to disabling stroke. These are things that as human beings we fear the most. And of course, many people getting increasingly visually impaired as the population ages. And the thing is, people want better research and treatments. They really demand it. And when we hold many patient days as part of our NIHR Biomedical Research Center at Moorfields, and they ask to take their little stickies and stick on what they want, you see a lot more stickies on the research side. Patients, people, really want research. And why? As Andrew mentioned, I was president of ARVA, and the president gets to choose the theme of the meeting. It's a big meeting, it's about 12,000 people. And before I chose the theme, I looked at the audience of 12,000 the year before, and I thought, what have they all got in common, from the most junior researcher to the Nobel Prize winners in the audience? And they have one thing in common. They want to feel, they want to make a difference. I think we all do. And so I call the theme of the meeting life-changing research. And I invited a couple of Nobel Prize winners to speak, Oliver Smithies, who's British, brought up in Yorkshire, who came from a tiny town there, was well taught, and he showed some pictures of his nursery school, and he just took us through his, and he captured the audience of 10,000. Absolutely, they were spellbound by his story of how he just discovered things. He was the first person in the world to do something called chromatography, protein chromatography. In the old days, they used to use filter paper. But he remembered that when he was a child, he used to have to starch his father's shirts. So being a rather playful sort, he used to put a little bit of blue dye in there just to see how interesting it was. When he came to separating the proteins, he remembered this. And so he used a starch gel. And basically, protein electrophoresis was born. Virtually every scientist in the whole world has done this. And then experiment and discovery after discovery. And then Roger Tien, who described green fluorescent protein, all these beautiful green pictures you see, part of that is Roger Tien. So these are truly extraordinary. And Chris Murray there, who works for the Gates Center, producing world morbidity data for all diseases of the world. So life-changing research, and research really is life-changing, as I will show you as I go along. It involves our most important supporters, our patients, the people we look after, and this is the Sight, Loss, and Vision Priority Setting Partnership. And more people were involved in this than any other disease. We had probably replies 10 times higher than any other disease. And it really has set some priorities for research in the UK. And I'll tell you why it matters. This is the bionic chip eye, for the eye. And when you measure vision after you've had this chip, you can't measure a difference, much of a difference. But when the patients turned up to the licensing authority in the US, they said things like, I know when the sun is setting, I know when my son's come in the room, I know. These are the sort of basic human things, and it was their testimony that got the device through the FDA, the regulatory authority. So people are our most important supporters. But let's move on to blinding diseases, a huge unmet disease, worldwide need, everything from cataract to trachoma, to the back of the eye with diabetes, with retinal detachment, with uveitis down on the left there, and of course glaucoma. And why they're important is most of them are increasing with age. So if all of us lead a normal lifetime, one of these will affect everyone in this room. It's inevitable. So there's a great interest. And of course, you know, there's a huge amount of money spent in the world, $36 billion on drugs and devices for eye disease. But more than that, the human cost is immense. And it's not a series of diseases or eyeballs, it's human beings. And so this is one of them. Some of you may have seen the video of this young girl in the top left. She's got inflammatory disease, uveitis, of course, a disease that Andrew specializes in. And she's had retinal problems, she'd had cataracts, she's had terrible glaucoma, and after multiple surgeries, she's blind in one eye. And in the other eye, she's got a pressure, she'd had a pressure of 45 and cataract and everything. We managed to sort out her pressure with some of the newer techniques we've been doing, but she still has cataract. She's talking about what it means to her to lose her vision.
I was just going to ask you, really, compared to maybe 3 years ago or 4 years ago, do you think your eyesight's different? A lot?
Yeah. I can't read.
You can't read?
No, I can't read.
Do you miss that?
Yeah.
What about people's faces?
Yeah, recognising people.
That's difficult now,
yeah.
Is it?
Unless they talk and I recognise their voice as well.
Really?
Yeah.
Can you see Mum's face now?
No, not if I can.
And what about the things that she used to do and doesn't do?
I think it's the drawing, because she's a very, very good artist, and that's the
big thing,
yeah,
you know,
she used to do some wonderful drawings for me, and I do miss that. I think it's that, the art.
And you just don't do that anymore.
No, not really.
So what were you saying then?
Don't make any mistakes.
So please don't make any mistakes. No, okay. No pressure.
No.
Just, okay.
Oh,
all right, okay.
Don't make any mistakes. I think what she really means by that is, I suppose, do your best for me. She later confessed to me after the operation that she said that because she heard I don't sleep much, and she was trying to encourage me to get a good night's sleep before I operated. We'll see what happens to her later on. I'll talk a lot about glaucoma because obviously that's my interest, but it's a very good illustration of translation. It's a disease where the optic nerve gets compressed, and you can see here a little picture of the nerve being pushed in. And I'll show you this time-lapse video of how the nerve gradually gets pushed in and collapses. And of course, along with that, the little nerves, 1.2 million nerves that die, and you end up, these little children here, and you can see both, there's peripheral visual loss, but you can see in the middle here, there's a loss of contrast, and I'll come back to that later on. Huge disease. This is an enormous disease. It's the number one cause of irreversible blindness in the world. It's probably the number one cause of a nerve problem, what we call neuropathy. Increases with age, accounts for 20% or more of the patients, our patients in the UK, enormous resources. 70 million affected, 7 million blind. I flew into London the other day and I just thought, it's like landing here and every single person was blind from glaucoma. That's what it is. Enormous. And yet, it's not a top priority for the WHO. Why? Because we need a better one-off treatment for the disease. So the question is, what can research do to help us? Now, the issue of translational research, which is work done in the lab and then taking it through to the clinic, is quite rightly been termed the valley of death. And you can see these tightrope walkers here expressing that rather well, because it is like that. Very few things make it through from that valley of death. And so we need to do that, because the prize at the other end is so great. It's the prize of better treatments, treatments for that girl, and many, many millions of patients like her. So this is a more traditional picture of the bridge, and it extends all the way from discovery science to experimental medicine, further along the bridge, clinical trials, implementation, of course, and of course, the whole population. And if you fail, the thing about translational research, it's not like writing a really nice paper. That's like a beautiful desert island. You have to make a bridge from right across to the other end. If there's one rung missing, you don't make it. And so that's why translational research is so difficult. There are many, many things, and there are many things here. There's the Biomedical Research Center here, which fills this gap. The Academic Health Science Centers, and then further along here, there are things like Biobank and various other things like the networks, letting us improve things. And Biomedical Research Center, I head up the Eyes and Vision, and I set the mission as changing lives in London, UK, and the world. It's very important now for this to work, for universities and hospitals to work together. We've got some of the world's best universities here in the UK, and we've got some of the world's best hospitals. And for instance, in our hospital, we have a joint strategy, because just like the bridge needs to be joined up, if you don't join up healthcare with research, you don't get the translation. And so we have a joint strategy, because we need to work together to make that work. And this needs to happen throughout the NHS to make that work. This diagram just shows some of the themes, and that includes, of course, immune inflammation and immunotherapy, which Andrew Dick leads. And again, these are some of the things that will help us translate through. This is the type of support you need to translate. So what this shows is the bridge of a translation and some of the support systems that you may need. And some of these have begun to be provided by the National Institute of Health Research, which has been fundamental and transformational. Some of you may not know what the NIHR is, but I can tell you behind the scenes, it's transforming how research is carried out in the NHS. It has absolutely transformed how we do translational research, research trials, and everything else like that, because since its formation a decade ago. And so you'll be hearing more from this. You don't normally put your acknowledgements at the beginning, but you need a team game. And these are all the people throughout my career who have helped me, right, from my family, to my mentors, to my colleagues, to people who run clinical trials, to the other people, because translational research is a team game. It's like football. It's no good just being a good goalkeeper or a good striker. You need the whole team. And so that's one of the most important things. I'll now move into one of the reasons I went into research. When I was a senior trainee, a senior registrar, for those of you old enough to remember what that was, when I came on to as a senior registrar at Moorfields, but I think Mike Potts was there when I came onto the house, I admitted a child one night, because even if you were the senior doctor there, there was only one of you on and you had to do everything. And this child was very young and yet had six sets of nerves. Six sets of nerves. And she had glaucoma, raised pressure. She'd had many, many operations. She'd had 64 anesthetics by this time. They all failed to scar her. And over the time I looked after her for 6 months, she went blind. And I recall her mother asking me, "Can you help me?" And I couldn't. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what treatments there were. I didn't know if there was anything else I could do. And we couldn't. And so even years ago, I mean, we had a dream that what would she dream about for her child? Better surgery, of course, to keep the pressure down and save her child's life. And secondary, even a greater dream, some way of making the nerve better. But both impossible, really, at the time. And, of course, she went blind. And I'm very struck, you know, I used to think somebody else would do, somebody else will raise money, somebody else will do research. But actually that's not true. And actually, I think Mahatma Gandhi, I'll paraphrase what he said, which is, be the change that you want the world to be. And I think, interestingly, as individuals, we have that mantra, we sort of think somebody else will do it. But so I very foolishly, at that point, said I'll try and do research. So I was a bit naive at the time. I applied for what's called a Wellcome Fellowship. And surprisingly, was awarded 3 years funding to do a PhD and learn how to go back to the lab, learn how to grow cells at the end of my training scheme. So here's this disease, glaucoma, affecting an enormous number of people. Surgery, the only viable treatment. The main cause of failure is the little hole that you make, scars. Healing is important in every patient. Now, interestingly, at the time that I came into research, there was a big discussion about whether pressure was had any relevance to glaucoma. You wouldn't believe that nowadays. And while I was in Florida, I rang up somebody in Bascom Harbor, which is the biggest number one hospital in the, and I was asked to the glaucoma department. And I got through to Paul Palmberg, who you see down there, and he said, come and see me. And he spent his lunch hour talking to me. He'd done a beautiful meta-analysis of all the data in the world that actually suggested that IOP pressure was incredibly important, even though there was no single study data to show that. And actually, that so struck me, that was one of the reasons that I thought, like, maybe I'll go in to see what I can do about research. This next slide here summarizes about 10 years' work. And what it shows is that we had a clinical problem, scarring at the top of the eye here, where we've made a channel. On the big eye in a child, is that the one you saw go blind? Laboratory research looking at different agents and how this affected the little fibroblast cells that make scar tissue. The discovery that actually using very short applications of anti-cancer agents could put these cells to sleep for a very indefinite period. Even, and I dropped the exposure from 2 weeks down to 5 minutes, and still the cells were asleep, in some cases for months. Developed a new model of the disease, cell culture and the experimental model. Did experimental first proof of, in human beings and then large trials around the world. And at the time, although it's been superseded by other agents, it was the most common regimen in the UK and many countries abroad, and it taught us the principles that you could improve it. So at least we had a chance of improving the outcome of children like the one you saw. But there was a problem. Because when we started doing this aging, we got these big blebs, which are little sticking out things here, which were full of fluid. And of course, what I wanted was to turn into something much more diffuse. Because when you have a sticking out area with fluid in it, it can burst, it can leak, they can get infected, and if that happens, they can go blind. And so, again, driven by my patients, we then did further research to understand why this was happening. And we came up with a hypothesis because based on both clinical observation and lab research, now, this is a very important concept. It's the juxtaposition between seeing patients who need things and taking it back to models that you've learned in the lab that allows you to very rapidly think up new ways of doing things. And so we came up with a new hypothesis. You needed two things to get this little lump of fluid. You needed a ring of scar tissue, which we call the ring of steel, which people don't forget, and you needed fluid flowing out the front. What did this mean? It meant you had to try and do things differently. Now, this is the thing about research. It's do things differently. And so it meant that you had to do the opposite of what people were trying to do at the time. You had to increase the surface area of anti-scarring treatment, and you had to push the treatment back. And to cut another few years off this, basically we came up with what we call the more field-safer surgery system. Now, it's very interesting at the time because I had an American visit me at the time and I changed my surgery and things were going much better. And he was writing the chapter in the main textbook of glaucoma at the time. And he said he'd heard about this new way of doing the operation and he'd come to see me. So he came to watch us. Before that, I would show you, we were using working with other people, and this is engineering people, and these are the diagrams of how water flows around the eye. And that little video you saw there is a sort of simulation of how water spreads out underneath the skin of the eye. Now, interestingly, if you're working with scientists and other things, they look at things and they think about other things. And somebody, Jan Buremel, who was one of the postdocs working on, said, this is rather like a pancake. So this is pancake, because we recently, he said, why don't we do something for Pancake Day, which was, of course, Tuesday. So he started making a whole heap of pancakes at the weekend. And we published this. I've never published an article on the perfect pancake. But what I did was, when we did the press release, I added to it how a perfect pancake can help save sight. Because I knew that would be picked up. And sure enough, when the press release came out, here's it on the cover of Newsweek. That's Pierre Trudeau, the Canadian Prime Minister, tossing a pancake, by the way. And there's another very pretty little girl here saying, scientists are looking out to see, and although it's not their appetite, but glaucoma that's going to benefit from these rather delicious-looking pancakes. So I put that up because of two things. One, public interest. You've got to keep public interest. And I think my comment on that is how the science of everyday things that we do can actually help to change the treatment of medical conditions. And I think that's why it created so much interest around the world, because people like to feel they're sort of they have some relationship to that. By the way, my pancake cooking is a lot better now. So this is the More Feel Safer surgery, and I had a visit from the editor of the main textbook. And he said, so this was how we did it. So previously, we did a small treatment area, and I changed that to a large treatment area. Previously, he said to me, we did loose fixed sutures, and now you do tight adjustable special sutures, which you can adjust. We never did an infusion, now you do infusion, he said to me. I can't do the American accent, I'm sorry. He said, we used to make a large hole in the eye, and now you do a single small hole. We used to do a small flap in the eye, now you do a big one. And now we used to put the water out front, and now you put it at the back. So I said, you say tomato, and I say tomato. And we changed. We changed things based on research, how we do something for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years because of research. Did it make a difference? A huge difference. Because that picture on the left shows you the way the operation used to look. That picture on the right shows the other operations look now. And in terms of sight-threatening complications for the children, 20% before we did this change, 0.5% since we did the change, only because of research and the fact that we learned how to investigate a problem. There's actually a very nice story at the end of this, because I was giving a talk on a podium at the American Academy, just like this one, and Paul Palmberg came up, you remember, I showed him earlier, and he gave me a big hug on the stairs, and I thought, oh, that's very nice. I said, why have you given me a hug, boys? I always give people a hug when they've made life better for my patients and your new technique. And he says, I remember I was sitting in Sweden watching you, and I remember what time it was. I remember seeing that video, and I said, I'm going to change it. And he said, within 2 weeks, he knew that this was a revolutionary change for him. And it saved all his patients many complications. And I said, I'm very grateful to you, he said. So I said, Paul, you won't remember, but a young resident came to see you many years ago. You gave him your lunchtime. You changed how he thought about things. That resident went on to do research. And I said, that resident was me. So I'm only returning to you what you gave me those years ago. So again, that's the other aspect of research. It's the give and take and the spreading of knowledge that then goes on. You never know when it comes back to you. And since we've been doing things better since research, the incidence of significant complications has considerably improved. That's a recent big UK study. Originally, there was the big UK national study that was done, and that was a very important study. And then these are the more recent figures that are coming out of national surveys and our own figures. Huge drop in complications, much safer surgery. And we've done studies around the world showing that you can improve outcomes using very simple applications. And this is a study we did in Kenya showing that you could improve the success rate with a simple application of these very inexpensive anti-cancer agents, about 20 cents. And we're looking at ways to treat other scarring diseases such as trachoma, for which causes blindness, one of the other things that you saw on the picture there. The other thing that the scarring has shown us is that if you get the pressure very low, you stop the disease in the majority of people. But the problem is most people don't achieve those results. And one of the reasons for that is people are different. So if you look at the results, the same surgery, the same surgeons, the same anti-scarring agents, all without, you can see that patients who are white Caucasians do very different from Indian Caucasians to those of African descent. So we have differences, and the question is why? And this is a grading system that Tony Wells and Joanne Marks did. This is the Morfields grading system. And what it shows that if you have, this is the grading of redness, okay? There's other grades as well. And it shows that if you have a red eye, your chance of failing at week 1 and 2 is nearly 3 times normal. If you have a red eye like that at 4 weeks, it's nearly 4 times normal. And if it fails, if it's like that at 6 weeks, it's 6 times normal. So it's teaching us that there are other things going on, and inflammation, again, which I will discuss with Andrew, is very important. These stories of improving outcome are very important because this is the UK University's publication after the what we call the REF exercise for what important impact research has been done in the UK, and the glaucoma surgery story was chosen as one of the ophthalmology stories. But the thing about research is it always leads to other research. So one of the issues is about healing. Healing is something we all take for granted. Every day we cut ourselves. Why? Because we brush our teeth. When you brush your teeth, you cut yourself, you're doing microabrasions all the time with that wonderful toothbrush that's going round and round or up and down. And you heal. You don't even know it. If you didn't heal properly, your mouth would be a mass of scar tissue, huge scars. You wouldn't be able to eat properly. You wouldn't be able to breathe properly. So why not? Why don't we get that scar? So some of the basic issues are very important. How do tissues contract? So again, this is where cell studies come in, and this is a fibroblast reeling in a strand of collagen, which is what we're all made of. And you can see how it will contract tissue. We can now look at tissues in living tissue. And the thing about scarring and how tissues contract and how they heal is very important. This is an 83-year-old lady who has been treated with what's called chemical rejuvenation. Essentially, it's painting your face with acid. And if you get it right, and you don't overscar, you get contraction of the tissue. So I'm just going to touch here, and there's a time lapse here. And this is her after her treatment. So what that shows is the power of healing, the extraordinary power of scarring and healing processes if we can control them. I don't like showing that slide because nobody's interested in ophthalmology. They all want this treatment instead. So what's causing healing? What's responsible for this healing? I show this picture of Pope John because that's one of my patients there, actually. My first internet referral. It's a young Italian baby with lots of previous failed surgery, and he came and he did very well with the surgery that we did. And then about a few years later, he came back, and his eyes looked immaculate. But the pressure had gone up in one eye, in his right eye. I thought, why is this happening? He looks fantastic. He's not got any scarring, healing. And yet his pressure's gone up. Anyway, Mum very proudly presented this picture to me and said, I managed to get an audience with the Pope. I said, that's fantastic. And then, can I see the picture? And she gave me this picture, and I thought, I noticed it was kissing the eye that the pressure had gone up a bit. And I said, you look at me asking, what did you ask the Pope for? She said, well, of course I asked the Pope to heal him. I said, no healing, please. So I showed this picture because, of course, there are factors that we don't understand. And we need research to help us understand them. And, of course, one of the things we've been looking for is, what is it that makes some people scar more than others? And, of course, there are lessons in nature, which is that if you operate on the fetus in the womb, you don't get scarring, you get regeneration. Why? And of course, there are many things that are different in the womb, one of which is, again, inflammation. Another one is how the matrix, the collagen you're made of, forms differently. Another one is certain proteins that are present in adult wounds are much less prominent in the fetus. And of course, we did a trial called the TGF-beta antibody trial to knock out the TGF-beta to see if this worked. Now, the results, the eyes looked fantastic after the antibody, but the big trial couldn't show a difference. Why not? This rather squiggly looking graph here shows lots of different things, but that little white graph at the right hand, this is a survival curve where you start at 100% success, and as the graph drops, your success drops. This is experimental work. And what it shows is that if you give more injections of the antibody, you get a better success rate. So in other words, drug delivery. And so we spent a lot of time looking at how to better deliver drugs into the eye. Why? Because different people have different outcomes. And one of the things that's perplexing us, for instance, is why, if you make this little hole in the eye and you just do it on its own, or you make the little hole in the eye, you do it with a cataract operation, it does much worse. This little study here done by Delaney Sirodina when she was a trainee shows that this is a measurement of the protein levels in the eye after you do surgery. And in the full camera operation, they go up and they come straight down and there you are. And in the cataract operation, even though the eye looks immaculate, it's full of protein. So if any of you have cataract surgery, you will have protein in your eye for a long time. And that's because you expose the cells of the lens to the eye, which it's not used to seeing, doesn't like it. And of course, if you go full of protein, that protein contains things which stimulate scarring. And of course, that's the importance of prolonged, why you may get prolonged ocular scarring. And we've been looking at ways of revisiting inflammation. This is what we did some years ago, using what we call a dendrimer, which is like a little molecule, and you can add very common molecules to it. And of course, instead of working like a single drug acting on a single receptor, it can act by acting like a zipper, like a Velcro. And so if you do that, you can get very pronounced anti-inflammatory effects. The problem was we couldn't get rid of the toxicity, even though it was very, very effective at preventing scarring. The other thing we've learned, which doctors have known all their life, is that pain is bad. Well, we all know that, don't we? But pain is very bad for scarring. Because what we've learned, what we know when we're in medical school is that when we get hit or cut, our hand goes red. If I slap you very hard, you'll go red. And that's because there's a local reaction, but there's also a reaction that goes by your spinal cord and comes back down. So pain then causes the release of agents which cause scarring. So if you can block pain, you can block scarring, and that's led to us using local anesthetic, even if the patient's under general anesthetic. Now that doesn't seem logical, does it? But the fact is your local arc continues to work even though you're fast asleep from a general anesthetic. So again, that's been a very useful thing to learn. And also research has taught us that enzymes which help the contraction, and what you see there is a little artificial skin which is contracting a lot in the lower video, but in the upper video it's not contracting because these enzyme inhibitors are inhibiting them. And what this shows is that it also inhibits the scarring, and we're trying to work out ways of delivering better, ways of delivering, in this case, antibodies better. And all these show is that using angiography, putting in dye at the vessels, that we reduce the dilatation of the vessels rather than preventing new vessels from growing. So We've got some exciting and important ways of preventing scarring, and that's improved the outcome of patients a lot. So that's very exciting. What about the second one? What about making liver care the impossible dream? Well, if we're going to do that, we need to understand why the nerve is unwell in the first place. And although I've been in glaucoma for 20-some, you know, more than a quarter of a century, the mechanism of how glaucoma kills the nerve is yet to be fully determined. You wouldn't believe that, would you? Because that tiny little nerve head, which you're all using to look at me with, is 1/8 the surface area of your little finger now. Your life is going through a tiny little hole, 1/8 the surface area of your little fingernail. And it dies in glaucoma in a lot of people. Why? Is it just pressure crushing the nerve? That's what we thought. And it's important because it really matters to patients. This young man has lost his vision from glaucoma, and he's talking about why it's important.
You're just talking to me about, you know, the future, and you're talking about the sort of prospect of maybe at some point in the future having the sight improved. What were you meaning about that?
Future days, of course, tomorrow part is going to happen, my life will matter out.
Sure.
So to see those things happen and only so vitally important.
Sure.
And to have that chance is just so important to me and to so many other people in my position that it would just be great to have it.
When you say that chance, what do you mean?
The chance to see again.
Right.
Because for now, I was living the life of an average teenager.
Right.
Normal things, but of course, when you get older, more important things come along.
Right.
And that's what I want to have the chance to see. I think it's the mind thing, the kind of computer game,
yeah,
play a football or rugby match, or just seeing girlfriends, family, that kind of thing is so important to me. Just to see them now would be brilliant.
Right.
But of course, it's the memory. But after time, people's phases change, memory
right.
fades, so I want to be able to see future times. One most important thing is to see my children running around.
Right.
See, there, that would be the most important thing, and not to have that would be probably, it's probably the hardest thing to accept in future years, but hopefully I will have the chance to see that. That's
right.
What I hope. That's what I hope for every day.
Okay, so he's very eloquent talking about what he wishes for. So to do that, we're going to have to regenerate some aspect of his nerve. Is there any chance? Well, traditionally, the optic nerve is part of the brain and that doesn't regenerate. So we've not been very hopeful. And of course, many of these patients here, they have many problems like that. And of course, that's why we're very interested in what we call regenerative medicine. Gene therapy, where you've got a single gene effect, is somewhat easier. I say easier, I mean, it's all relative, to correct the gene that's missing and perhaps correct the metabolic defect. But of course, putting in new stem cells, everybody's very hopeful about this rather strange new field, stem cells. How can that be important? And of course, we've got many different initiatives going on in the different disease, from corneal disease to macular degeneration to diabetes to glaucoma, and then, of course, the optic nerve. Now, gene therapy has made big strides. And this wonderful video shows a young man who's got a gene defect, and he's going blind at his young age, and he's pretty well blind. And here he's trying to go through an obstacle course. And this is from Robin Ali and Jim Bainbridge. And there he is, making his way through an obstacle course at Morphosis, a pedestrian mobilization facility. And every time that thing goes red, he's touching something. In other words, he doesn't know where he's going. And he's got a little headset just to track his head movements. And you can see he's wandering all over the place and he's touching everything. So in other words, he can't see. 77 seconds, 8 navigation errors, he can't see. Black. This is him 6 months after his gene therapy. Quite extraordinary. No sound, quite extraordinary. So what that shows is the amazing potential now of various aspects of regenerative medicine. And of course, for single gene defects, that's extraordinary. But of course, the things we're talking about, glaucoma, is much more complex than that. So it's really unlikely that a single gene correction will help for patients. And this young man, unfortunately, he was blown up by a bomb left on his car. And Mark Hallerly, who was the producer of the series, made a very moving picture about what, recording about him talking about what it meant to him to lose his vision. His optic nerve, although his eyes are still intact, his optic nerves have been very damaged. And here he's talking about that.
20/20 sight for 32 years, and now it's by God, you miss it. For seeing human emotion. It's reading people's faces. It's understanding how they feel without asking them. Joy, surprise, a little bit sad. I guess it's just seeing other people, because it gets pretty lonely in here. It'd be nice to see people's faces from time to time. Just over a year ago, I saw my daughter being born. That is one of the most wonderful, wonderful sights. And obviously, unfortunately, if we have another child, I won't see that child be born, I won't know what that child looks like. It is unfair. It's shitty. Bloody unfair. Oh. Sometimes I think, God, what's it going to be like for the next 40 years? Or longer? Unfortunately, I won't see Lucy grow up. Really gets me. Really, really gets me.
Well, that's an extraordinary recording. And really, for optic nerve therapy at the moment, cell therapy offers our biggest hopes, and you can get cell therapy from eyeballs, from the nose, interestingly, pluripotent cells, obviously the embryonic cells, and bone marrow, or actually the brain. So this is an interesting, and this picture is 10 years old. Bob Wanreb and I wrote a review for The Lancet in 2004, looking at how this wonderful ganglion cell, which extends all the way from your eye into your brain, out of the eye into the brain, right into the back and up to the back of the brain, it's how it can get damaged in your coma. And there are different ways, the circulation, autoimmunity, inflammation, but at the optic nerve head itself, where much of the damage occurs, you can see that there's, I've written here, astrocytes, the cells of the optic nerve. And this little story I want to tell you is really the story of how you work with other scientists. And this is Jeff Raisman. Jeff Raisman is a neuroscientist at UCL. He first described the word plasticity, actually, in the CNS. And he also described a series of cells in our nose which reproduce all the time and help us regrow olfactory nerve bulbs so that we can smell. Otherwise, we won't be able to taste anything properly because we're losing our olfactory bulbs all the time. And these little olfactory and sheathing cells help new nerves to go through your skull into your brain and join up with your brain. Now that sounds a bit like going back and rejoining your brain from the eye, doesn't it? So, quite understandably, we've been looking at ways to make things join up. And interestingly, he's used some of these on a man who's had his spine cut in half with a knife in Poland. And using these cells, he's got the man to partly walk again. And this was on a BBC program, Panorama. So, obviously, we've been very hopeful that this might be useful. But again, you never know what you're going to discover because he's such a fantastic neuroanatomist and we've been sort of looking at things again. We've been looking at, we published this new theory just this year, 2015. And this is the rat optic nerve. Now, the interesting thing is the human optic nerve is what's called a lamina quadrosa. The way I describe it to my patients, I said, if your eye was as big as a house, it'd have a hole in it, and it'd have like 20 trampolines in that hole, and your nerves would run out of the hole like spaghetti, 1.2 million pieces of spaghetti. The rat doesn't have a trampoline. All it has is a series of cells linking up the hole so that the spaghetti goes up, but there's no trampoline. And we thought that the collapse of the trampoline was absolutely necessary to get damage. But of course, it isn't. And what we've been looking at is the little cells called the astrocytes, which run quite long into, this is like half a fan. And these cells run along the sort of radial, like a spokes of a wheel. And they're very complicated little cells because they've got lots of branches, like a truncated tree. The other interesting thing about these cells is that they have lots of mitochondria. Now, mitochondria are the secret of life. They provide us with our energy so that we can get up in the morning, so that we can run, we can break Olympic records, or not, as the case in my case. But this cell has got giant mitochondria. It's producing tons of energy. This is not a mistake, it's doing something. And of course, they wrap around. Why do you have giant mitochondria? You produce energy, ATP. You have to do waste disposal of the axons, and you have to support the nerve. This is the cytoskeleton. And of course, what happens if the wind blows, this is what happens. I was at Glyndebourne, and now that I've done this work, every tree I see looks like an astrocyte. I thought, that looks like an astrocyte. Never mind the opera, this looks like an astrocyte. This was in Brisbane when I was giving talks at the Australian meeting. I thought, that one looks like an astrocyte. But the wind was blowing, and look what happened. Now, in the optic nerve, they aren't vertical like that, because the weightlifter can carry a big load vertically. If you put the weightlifter on the cell, they collapse, don't they? So if you turn the tree on its side, it collapses very quickly. Now, the interesting thing is, there are other cells we've been working on for many years called the Müller cells. And these cells run top to bottom in the retina. And we've been sort of trying to figure out for years what these cells are doing. And this is one theory, that they work as optical fibers. And there's a very nice paper in a journal called PNAS which shows that. But since we've been looking at these cells and their energy, we've been looking at the Müller cells again in a different light. And they're super powered. They've got fantastic mitochondria, big ones. Very interestingly, we have a public communication exercise every year. This is the winners this year, and it's a group of people working at the Institute. And what they've done is they've knitted a living retina. Mind you, it took them 2 years. So you imagine how long it took your retina to knit. And not only that, they knitted the Müller cells the wrong way around. So they had to re-knit them, they unstitch them and put them back in. But look how they stitched the Müller cell back in here, onto the nerve fiber layer. Their little feet wrapping all around the thing. And I said, why did you do that? Because we just discovered this, you see. So what did you do? I said, oh, it just seemed logical. Well, they got it right. Because that's what we think they're doing for the nerve fiber layer. This stain here shows energy in your eye. Very white behind the optic nerve, and just at the back of the optic nerve, it goes black. That means there's a nuclear power station just at the back of your nerve going front into your retina. Behind that, not much. Why? Why is that? That's because you have to see. This different stain here shows myelin, which is the sheath of the nerve fiber, and it stops at the back of the nerve. Now, myelin is what enables Djokovic to return a serve at 150 miles an hour, because your fiber, your conduction of your nerve is speeded up, and the energy consumption of the nerve goes right down. In other words, you go back into the eye, your energy consumption goes right back up, and the conduction goes down. So you're eating energy, all of you, are eating energy. So don't worry about dieting, your eyes will eat them all up. So, non-myelinated axons in your eye require much more energy. Why do you have non-myelin? Because you won't be able to see otherwise. Your ancestors who had myelin in their eyes all got gobbled up by T-Rex because they couldn't see properly, because the myelin will interfere with how the light gets through to the photoreceptor, which is behind it. So basically, those who didn't have myelin ran away from T-Rex, and those who didn't got gobbled up because they couldn't see it coming. Sorry, that's a rather simplistic explanation. So what happens in the rat? When you put the pressure up, these little fibers in the periphery begin to disintegrate. Now, we've never thought of this before. This is very interesting. You know, 25 years I've been in this thing, and this is new. What happens then is the little axons which run through the fingers of the tree begin to swell, and then they shrink and they die. So in other words, the tree is necessary for the axon, the long nerve, to survive. Why? Well, this picture of a giraffe here tells you the answer. If you're not a giraffe's neck, it generally dies. And this picture you see on the right here is what's happening in all your eyes all the time. Little organs are going up and down, up and down, up and down. And what happens there is if you put a kink in it, or you take away its supply, it begins to back up. It's like a traffic jam. It swells, and then it shrinks, and then it dies. The whole motorway dies. And that's why we think the cells are dying in glaucoma. Now this is new, this is not something, but this is only the sort of thing that only research can give you a hope. And what happens is that as the tree, the axon retracts, as the pressure goes up, the axons die more and more from outside in. Guess what? That's exactly what happens in the human. So, essentially, the elephant in the room, now this is why research always leads you to very interesting things, is the fact that there's constant stress on your nerve. 60 times a minute, your nerve is being hit. What by? By your pulse. So if you think about your optic nerve, and that trampoline is your optic nerve, I talked about the trampoline. So, now, as you get excited, your blood pressure goes up and the pulse pressure increases. And this is what's happening to your optic nerve as you're sitting there writing. And of course, the higher your pressure, the higher the elephant is going. And this is happening to your optic nerve 60 times a minute. So I better put some eye drops in and reduce the pressure a little bit. So the elephant's gone for a little walk now, so the pressure's been taken off your optic nerve. So you can imagine, your optic nerve has to put up with this for 100 years or more. So, is this correct? That's why your eye and the anterior nerve consume so much energy, because it's coming under this assault. I looked on the internet, and there's a chap called Cyclops, who's from a film called X-Men, and he has awesome power in his eyes. But in fact, Stan Lee, I think, who did X-Men, I think it's Stan Lee, didn't realize that he got it right. Because if you had eyeballs the size of your consumption per milligram, they'd be the size of footballs. Because your eyes are eating energy all the time. And of course, there's a nuclear power station at the front, going into the retina, and there's the 240 volt power supply behind it. What are the implications? The implications are beginning to make us understand why people with glaucoma have specific problems. They get visual field constriction, you saw that picture, but they complain of things much more than that. They complain of not being able to see steps, dark light, light dark. And this picture from the Maracanã Stadium in Brazil, because I'll stop telling you about all these places I'm visiting in later, you'll get the impression I don't do much work back at Morpheus. But this is the Maracanã Stadium in Brazil, when I was the guest speaker there some time ago. And you can see it's in the darkened light. Now, for those of you who watch sport, you'll notice that when the TV cameras have a stadium like this, they cannot cope. The dark is too dark, the light is too dark. And no matter whether you increase the aperture, or the pupil of the camera, it can't cope. So why is it that all of you can sit in the Maracana Stadium and watch that football match and think, no problem, the people in the dark are fine, the people in the light are fine. It's because you see these little chairs here? These are your individual ganglion cell receptor fields. And what they're doing is they're volume controlling it. So as the light and dark sweeps across your retina, you're saying up, down, up, down, up, down, and you're controlling it perfectly so that you can see. So I can look at you, and some of you in the shadow, some of me is in the shadow, and you can see both of bits of me. Because the bits that are falling on your retina, now that's a very, very energy-consuming activity. And while I was in Brazil, by the way, I've always been fascinated by this young girl from Ipanema. So here she is. She's 69 years old now. Looking good. She's got good mitochondria. And the picture I've used here, because you can see the sun behind, you can see her face, so your contrast is good in that picture. And you can only do that if you have a very adaptive or very clever camera tricks. So what do glaucoma patients find really difficult? This is what they find difficult. Dark light. And if you hear patients with advanced glaucoma talk, when they're going along the place, dark light, 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 it's as if they cannot see, they've gone blind. Because their nerves can't respond fast enough to this change of darkness. They literally say, it's like I've gone blind, I can't cope with it. So it's not just the visual field, it's the fact they can't cope with different... I'm sorry, I seem to be taking you on my travels with this thing, but this is Hyderabad, where I gave a lecture some time ago. And you can see, imagine driving a car in Hyderabad if you've got glaucoma. Black and white, dark, coming left, right, and center. If your processing is slowed down, you just can't cope with that, and that's exactly what the problem is in glaucoma. That's much more of a problem than the visual field. So, energy supply, normal and raised pressure, and aging. With aging, you have increased trauma, and you have energy failure. Those of us, I know most of you are very young here, but those of like me who are getting older will understand it when I say aging is energy loss. I think everybody's nodding there. It's okay. So if this hypothesis is correct, you'd expect more glaucoma with as you got older than predicted by the pressure in the eye. True. You'd expect people, as you scan them as they got older, 80, 90, 100, you'd expect them to look like they got glaucoma. True. That's what's happening now with the very longitudinal studies that are being done. And so, of course, you cannot cope. And when you have light going in and out of the eye, you can't cope with that, with the visual field defect. And of course, you have problems with dark light contrast. That word says dark light contrast difficult. And you can see why dark light contrast for a glaucoma patient is very difficult. So, what cells have got power in them? Well, olfactory and sheathing cells, which you use every day, the Müller stem cells, which you may or may not use every day. And so, one of the questions we're asking is, can we use these? Now, the problem about putting in cells into the eyes is you get scarring. You get inflammation and you get scarring. So we've had to use various techniques to prevent that. So, but you can get that in if you use the right anti-scarring agent. And interestingly, if you damage the ganglion cells, what this funny little diagram here shows is that this is the normal electrical test. It's a special test called the super threshold. If you damage all the ganglion cells, it goes flat. And if you put in transplant, you get a restoration of some electrical function. So that's very promising. What about if you put them into the optic nerve head, like we're doing here? Well, you can see the cells wrapping their cells around the cells that are in danger. And I like to think of it rather like this picture here, you know, providing comfort, support, occasionally waste disposal. And it's very much in the analogy and nutrition, and it's just a fantastic analogy of what these cells are doing in your optic nerves, we think. So what happens if you inject these cells then? Well, this is a normal optic nerve head, and you can see it looks okay on the staining. If you put the pressure up, this is all the dead area. These two little islands here are all that are left of the optic nerve with a raised pressure. What if you do a transplant And you can see here the survival is far, far greater in an eye that's had the extra cells transplanted. And I think this is very exciting because we're going through a time where we've got new machines that can actually visualize the individual cells of the living eye. All our imaging of the optic nerve now that's done in the clinic is just the structures. It's missing the bit that really matters, which is the cells and the axons. Now, with modern methods of imaging. So this is a picture of the astrobot, as you can see, using much better optics and also getting up closer. And this is an adaptive optic pseudo-color picture of your retina. This is the bit of the retina you're using, and these are the individual cells of the retina. You have to use the Hubble Space Telescope turned inwards, which takes care of all the aberrations of our eye before we can see each individual cell. And obviously we're hoping for that. And we're hoping to be able to do that because this is the Crick Institute in London, which we hope to be near. And we'd like, of course, ophthalmology to be the eyes of the Crick. What do I mean by that? I mean that actually by being able to look into the human body and blood vessels and the nervous system, we'll be able to look at things and do things that the neuroscientists at the Crick, which is going to be Europe's biggest science institute, cannot dream of doing in a million years. And that will give us insights into what's going on in the brain. It's interesting, we've been doing the biobank, led by Paul Foster, and Dr. Fang from Harvard has been doing some analysis. And interestingly, the fine detailed scanning of our eyes correlates fantastically with the cognitive loss that we all suffer as we get old. It correlates better than any other factor we found in the database so far. In other words, the scan of your eye can tell you perhaps what's going to happen in the future. So it's a fantastic reflection of what's going on in our brains. So can we re-energize the optic nerve?
You remember what we were saying about what it would mean if we could turn the clock back just a few years. What would that mean?
You honestly would be giving your life back.
Right.
Honestly. And the other thing actually is I would be able to enjoy what I did before and not feel imprisoned like I am now. I feel imprisoned, really.
What do you mean by imprisoned?
I feel isolated. I feel by not doing the things I used to be able to do because I was able to see, I can't, I just become, I become isolated, I become inward. I don't go out with things anymore. I just sit at home and I can't watch television, I can't, not that's important. I normally love nature. I move to where I am because we have, from every room, we've got the sight of a lake and now I can't see it. So it's horrible.
So what does the research mean here? It means that actually we have new ways of looking at problems. We have ways where improvement is a possibility. Every week I get asked by my patients, is there any research that might help me improve my nerve? Now, I can say, there is. There is. It's only experimental, and it's only because of experimental work that we've got this far. But it gives us insights into how we can maybe turn a nerve that looks like that, maybe a bit more into a nerve that looks like that. So it gives us hope. Research at its least gives us fantastic hope. At its best, it gives us the dreams of tomorrow. So finally, we must still control the pressure. And I told you about the pressure being the key issue, and traditionally we had a lot of drops of pressure, and then we had a honeymoon period where the pressure was good, and then the pressure rose in a lot of patients. So our aspirations now, with better scarring control and better surgery, which I haven't really had that much time to talk about, would be that we bring the pressure down rate control to a very good level and keep it there for the rest of the patient's life. Because of that, I set a global challenge for glaucoma. and it's called the 10-10-10 challenge. It's for a pressure of 10 millimeters of mercury, which we know arrests the disease in most patients, most people around the world. The next 10 is going to last for 10 years for most people. That will keep them going for the rest of their lives. But the most difficult challenge is the last 10, to do that in 10 minutes. And we have to do that because around the world, you see that map of glaucoma, you can see where it's bright red. Africa, Far East, Middle East, and some other parts, where the only option is a one-off treatment. That's why it's not a global priority. We don't have a one-off treatment. We now have better treatments to prevent scarring, and we have better devices, and we're hoping very much that. I wouldn't have said this before, but I now see 10-10-10 as a real prospect for the future for this enormous disease, which we've had relatively little impact on. So finally, this is a video about research in the NHS. And it starts with ophthalmology, and there's that little girl you saw.
Rhiannon Willis is having a checkup to make sure her eyesight is okay. She's doing well now, but this is her a few years back. Rhiannon nearly lost her sight to cataracts, but doctors here at Moorfields Eye Hospital carried out a life-changing operation. This is the very moment Rhiannon and her mum discovered she could see for the first time in 2 years.
Maybe?
Oh, wow.
Rhiannon's operation would not have been possible without research. When it was set up in 2006, the National Institute for Health Research recognised the importance of translating research from the lab and using the findings for NHS patients like Rhiannon. The NIHR has already linked some of our leading universities.
And when you help one patient, actually, with research, you help many. This was the kids' hospital, because we treat so many children now. We worked out of an old peeling Victorian ward that had peeling walls, and of course we couldn't raise money. And Rhiannon came back and helped us fundraise. And this is our new children's hospital, built entirely from charity. It cost £50 million actually, but if we'd done it on PFI, private finance, it would have cost us £60 million. That would have wiped out our profit for the next 10 or 20 years. Any money that we made, that we put back into the NHS, would be gone. So, you know, they can, you know, research returns many things to us. And this was built on research. And there you see she quite aptly laid the foundation stone for our fabulous building. And I suppose my final slide here is that research changes lives. You'll recognize some of this. That's her now. She's gone to university. She's graduated. She's got a good job. That's the same young girl. You'll recognize here Miss Etherington here with her Paralympic gold medals, and we've been able to keep aside enough for her to do that. This young lady came with very little vision, but we managed through research to do a treatment to save her remaining sight, and there she is winning the voice. This young man is the mascot for the All Blacks. You can see him again, he's done well. And this young man is now grown up. They're all examples of really how research truly changes lives. If you think back to that child that I saw years ago, who I had nothing, nothing, and you can see how different life is now. So really, in conclusion, I'm very pleased to be here at the National Eye Research Center. Obviously, the research that's going on here changes lives. Research changes. And it makes it better, and it continues to make it better. So it's very, very important that this continues. And of course, here you have your final slide talking about the National Eye Research Center, its 30-year history, the money that's raised, and the research that's gone on to help so many people. So thank you for asking me to give this lecture. Thank you for coming. And I hope you enjoy listening to some rather roundabout lectures, but how important research is for us now. Thank you.